Now, in the continuation, I would like to show you some example when elasticity is also taken into account in the modeling. So far, we only dealt with plasticity, and as I said, that there are polycrystal work for cyclic deformation, where the amplitude of the strain is small, and the elastic part can be quite large. So I will present you a work in which this modeling takes into account elasticity as well. We also, at the same time, we look at an example, experimental example. This is a magnesium alloy AZ31, which was studied in fatigue. So we look at the experimental results and also look at how modeling can be done. The experiments were done by my co-author Chengfeng Gu in Australia, and then we did the modeling after with crystal plasticity using the Taylor-Lin model, not the self-consistent model, but the Taylor-Lin model, which appeared to be very efficient for low, small cyclic deformation. So the initial material had a very strong texture because an EBSD map, here you see an EBSD map of the material, which was a sheet material, only shows basically red color, means that the axis, there's a common axis, crystallographic axis, which is red, so it's about here, this is basal pole. The basal poles are oriented very much parallel to the surface of the sample, and only differences are in the rotation around this axis, which doesn't change the color. The color is the same, but there are big orientation differences between the same red grains. So that is the material before cyclic deformation. As you can see, it does not show any twins. There are no annealing twins in the initial material. And we will see that during cycling, a lot of twinning will appear. So what will be interesting in this work is also to see how twinning can be modeled in polycrystal plasticity. The fatigue testing was, of course, cyclic, and here is the loading in axial direction. So it was compression, but compression and compression, meaning that as a function of time, here is the zero position, and then delta Z is the change in the length of the sample. So it was compressed, and then it was lengthened, but less than the initial length. It remained in compression, and then again compressed, lengthened. This is called the so-called compression-compression, but indeed, in reality, there is also tensile strain here. This is a compression stage, this is a tensile stage, compression and compression, compression and tensile. Small amplitude, you see, the strain is at this position is 10 to the minus 3 only, so 0.001. And here the strain is larger, is 4.5 times larger, but still very small strain. This strain is although small, but it includes plasticity. Large part of deformation is elastic, and the other big part, but smaller actually, is plastic. So here we need the Taylor-Lin model, which plastic and elastic at the same time. Elasticity is included. So look at the texture before, and here the aspect ratio is not perfect. Our pole figures are not circular. I know there is a way to change the aspect ratio. Anyway, for the moment we have to live with this. So look at the experimental textures before testing and after testing on two different pole figures. So these pole figures come from EBSD, but the maps were quite large, so we have quite a good statistics. So before testing, it can be seen that the normal direction, the basal poles, the 0002 poles, are oriented mostly in the normal direction. This is why we saw so many red grains in the EBSD image. On the 1010, this is a prismatic plane projection. Of course, if it is in the middle, then the prismatic planes have to be on the outside. So the green orientations are here for the prismatic directions. So after 6,000 cycles of fatigue deformation, this is what we see. We see that in the middle there are the texture is the same in the middle, so texture basically didn't change, but there are some new reflections appear in these two positions. There was nothing before, and now there is something. Those are the twins, actually. We will show right after that there are plenty of twins after cyclic deformation. And here there is something which appearing in the middle also. Now, cyclic deformation is, of course, is such that we measure the stress-strain curve in a cyclic manner. So here is the strain which is applied. It is always negative. Here is the zero, minus 0001, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6. So it's always negative. And here is the stress response of the material. The zero is here, so from here this is a tensile region, tensile stress, and here this is compression stress. Because the testing involves tensile stages, but the total strain is always negative. So here we have two cycles are shown up to cycle number 5. It begins here the experiment, okay, and then from here the cycling is done up to this amplitude. Even after 500 cycles, we can see that it's kind of stable hardening curve is visible here. Does not evolve much. This is the maximum tensile point, and then when it is unloaded, this is the unloading stage, yeah, it's not perfectly straight, which means that not only elasticity is happening here, but something else. And this is loading in compression. So this is a strain hardening curve in compression, including the elasticity. And then here it continues in tension, goes up to this point, and compression, tension, in a cyclic manner. The polycrystal model, because it includes hardening, or because it is able to reproduce the stress strain behavior of the material, also permits us to reproduce this hardening curve. The simulation has to be such that at the same time we get the hardening response of the material correctly, and also the texture variation, if there is any. And there is a lot of twinning, so we have to get also the twinning activity well reproduced. So So this simulation is quite complex because many things are going to be simulated and reproduced. This is a very good example for the power of possibilities by polycrystal modeling. So this is the microstructure after 5,000 cycles. No, 6,000. 6,000 cycles. You see there are many red. Those are the initial grains. And they remained red. They didn't change their orientation. But there are plenty of twins here, which appeared in many grains, almost all of them twinned. A twinning volume fraction or surface fraction can be estimated about 15% from this map. So twinning happened, and the purpose would be also to reproduce this twinning, not only the 15% here, but we were much more ambitious. We wanted to reproduce the twinning one by one in each grain. So how one can do that? For that you have to know exactly what was the initial orientation of the grain, because here we see the final orientation after 6,000 cycles. But it is actually possible because this is fatigue simulation with small amplitude. Of course, after 6,000 strains in each cycle having 0.2% of strain, it amounts to a total strain of 12. But this is always positive, negative, with a big part is elastic. So the grains, they rotate a little bit, but they always rotate back and forth. So small orientation changes happen. And when we just look at the simulation, so we take initial orientation sets from the experiment, we put into the modeling, and then make the cyclic deformation, we find that the orientation doesn't change just within 1 degree or so. So actually, then if you see here a grain, then its orientation is like before, not only after. So we know the initial orientation of the crystal because it's about the same as the final one. That's a big chance to apply and to verify grain by grain, taking exactly the same map. This is the experimental map. Here there are the so-called mother grains and also the twins. The mother grains are the red ones, and here we see the twins which appear in different variants. So we just use the mother grain orientation. We do the simulation and then we try to identify whether these variants appear or not and in what volume fraction. So to understand how one can do such sophisticated modeling, I present you a little bit in more details the mechanics of the Taylor-Lin model and then the scheme of twinning, how to deal with the twinning simulation, and then show the modeling parameters and see the results. So the model approach itself, so this is how the sample was. The basal planes are oriented in direction 2. And the cycling was done vertically in this direction. The reference system is 1, 2, and 3. In this reference system, only in direction 3 was applied the cyclic deformation, and because it has planar shape, these shear components macroscopically cannot happen on the sample. And we don't know how much would be the strain in direction 1 and direction 2, because we do not impose that. So they are left free. This is a mixed boundary condition experiment, as in general, almost all experiments are mixed boundary conditions, except ECAP, which is fully constrained. So if this is the velocity gradient tensor, then the stress state has to be like that, because these strain components are free, unknown. We put zero stresses here. Anyway, there were no stresses applied perpendicular to the sheet. It's only these stresses happen, and no stress was applied also in the width direction. So this has to be zero and zero. And the other components, we don't know, because if we impose the strain, then we cannot impose the stress. They have to be complementary, mixed boundary conditions. So this is the macroscopic definition for the deformation and for the stress state. Now, how the mechanics is built up when we have to take into account elasticity. We know actually the plastic part, how to do. You recognize some equations here for the plasticity. So plasticity is here, and here is the elasticity treatment. So that is the velocity gradient, the macroscopic velocity gradient applied on the material. The macroscopic velocity gradient is in relation with the strain gradient tensor, F dot F minus 1. And then, indeed, this was a so-called large strain formalism, what used in this work, which I did not touch in the present course, the large strain formalism. It's another mathematics. This is, of course, applied for large strains. And you can find all the elements in my short course note, which is another file I'm going to put today on the Google Drive. You can download. And if you have time and courage to look into the mathematics of that part, then you will learn a little bit more. So in that approach, it is one has to know the strain gradient, and starts with the strain gradient, which is decomposed into LP and FP. So this is the plastic part of the strain, the LP, plastic velocity gradient, which is by slip made by gamma dot times S0. S0 is the name here for the Schmidt tensor, which is multiplication of the slip direction and the slip plane. This is how, with usual tensor notation, it is shown. So this is the Schmidt orientation tensor. This is the slip rate. And for the slip rate, we use the viscoplastic slip. So this constitutive law, what you now know quite well, with tau 0 and then so on, and with m. And then we follow how the orientations are changing, the direction of the slip and the normal to the slip plane. They are changing with the strain gradient tensor, which is transforming from the initial state into the final state, the orientation of the slip plane and slip direction, in this way. So this is the initial orientation of a slip system for N and B, and both of them are transformed during the calculation. This is the plasticity part. Now what is very different, of course, is the elasticity. We didn't touch elasticity at all during the course, but it has to be done. So for the elasticity, you also define an elasticity tensor which describes the elastic part of the deformation. Here we have to use, to be coherent with the plasticity part, the so-called elastic green strain, which is defined by the elastic gradient deformation tensor. It's very similar to the one which I presented you for plasticity. The difference only that the elastic gradient is used here. And then we relate the deformation to the stress. The stress is simply the multiplication of the elasticity tensor with the elastic green elastic tensor that gives the stress state on the material. So here elasticity is directly, of course, related to the stress. No problem in elasticity. It's much more complicated in the plasticity. So here is the, by this operation, when we use the elastic green tensor, we obtain the so-called second Piola-Kirchhoff stress tensor here, from which the Cauchy stress tensor can be also obtained by a mathematical operation. Usually the Cauchy stress, which is used which is not measured in experiments. But the simulation of elasticity for large strains has to go in this way. And here is the boundary condition for the stresses, which has to be respected. The stress state is actually always kind of elastic. There is no elastic stress and plastic stress. There is just one stress state in the material. It always comes from basically from elasticity, the stress state. So it can be always calculated from the elastic strains. Because during plastic strain, elastic strains are present and they are representing actually producing the stress in the material. So we have a large number of grains, and the average of all these stresses which they produce have to agree with the boundary condition, meaning that zero stresses have to be here, and here there can be stresses, but they are not imposed. But these have to be respected. So the simulation is a kind of double iteration procedure. Always for the single crystal strain equation to obtain the slip distribution, we solve the strain equation. And then we obtain the result, and we look whether the boundary conditions, these stresses are really zero. If not, we have to change a little bit L11 and L22 to adjust so that finally the integral of all the stresses in the green population will be zero. So the boundary conditions have to be satisfied. So this is the elasticity and plasticity. They are combined together. The Taylor-Lean model is such that it is assumed that the elastic strain plus the plastic strain together are the same in each grain. You already wrote it, but I will write again on the board. This is not self-consistent modeling. Because strains are small. So the elastic strain, like L, I will write it small, L, elastic strain of a grain plus the plastic strain of a grain is equal to the macroscopic velocity gradient applied on the material. This is known, and only the sum of those that is known. The partition between elastic and plastic strain is not known. Only the sum of it. But this calculation permits to obtain them, both elastic part and both the plastic part. So we know how much they deform the grains individually, one by one, elastically and plastically. Now, this is the crystal plasticity model, but we also introduced implemented twinning. Twinning is quite tricky, because when twinning happens, then part of the crystal changes orientation, and radically. So we have to produce those orientations. This is the so-called mother grain, which can produce twinning in it. If we take the extension twins, which is usually happening in magnesium, there are six of them. So one mother grain can present six different variants appearing inside. Now the approach here was that we predefined each of these possible twins. They have different orientations with respect to the mother grain, but we know where they should be. So before starting the simulation, we had the mother grain orientations, and to those mother grain orientations, we added six other grains which were already in twinning position with respect to the mother grain. Of course, they had zero volume fraction initially. So it's like tiny grains with no volume. What is important is the orientation is already there, but no volume in it initially. Only the mother grain has a volume. But all the twins predefined, they don't have any volume. And then deformation goes on, and there are twinning planes, twin directions, orientation differences between them, and six new grains for each initial mother grain. And then a kind of volume is attributed to these grains, to these twins, progressively. Actually, the twinning is considered in the simulation as a kind of slip. Indeed, twinning is very similar to slip. Slip is shear deformation, and twinning is also shear deformation. Only difference that twinning requires an instant kind of instantaneous large strain, while the slip is built up with small Burgers vector deformations. So we know how much strain, the so-called twinning strain, gamma twin is here, would belong to 100% twinning. If that amount of shear, the so-called twinning shear, is applied on the mother grain, that amount of twinning shear is happening, the mother grain is completely twinned into its single twin component. Here I think it's about 0.13 shear deformation. So imagine if the mother grain is only sheared 0.13 in a given well-oriented twinning system, then it is completely replaced by its twin. So, but if it is sheared less, then only a fraction of its volume appears as a twin. So we have to calculate what would be the activity in this so-called twinning slip system, pseudo-slip, which is gamma dot here. In a time increment, the shear will be, twinning shear will be that one, and the fraction of it with respect to the shear needed for 100% twinning will give how much fraction of the volume we should attribute to the twin. And this is progressively added to the twins automatically for each variant, for all these six variants. So this is the philosophy how the twinning can be handled. We call it a volume transfer scheme of twinning. It means that volumes are attributed to the twin variants, and all the twin variants are predefined and they are already there. there is other twinning scheme. Another one is implemented actually, unfortunately, in the Los Alamos self-consistent code, which is not this scheme. This scheme is much more powerful and gives detailed individual results, grain by grain, which agree with experiments. So much more, much better. Now, a selection criterion was applied here also for the different twinning variants. We were preferring twins which were produced with the minimum energy, elastic energy. So the elastic energy for each twin was calculated. And then those were preferred which had a lowest energy. But the most important is that detwinning was allowed. Detwinning is when, for example, you change the deformation direction opposite, and it is happening all the time in cyclic fatigue deformation. And then a mate twin can actually detwin and disappear, or partially disappearing. Although twinning can be made only just in one direction, but detwinning is possible, that the twin finally, it's like just moving the twin boundary, moving back when the loading is changed into opposite. And even it can happen just during unloading. You don't even change opposite the loading, just unload, and even then detwinning can happen. Magnesium AZ31 is especially detwinning material. And it was observed in situ experiments with synchrotron X-ray experiments that magnesium AZ31 is twinning enormously in a small amount of strain. But if you change opposite, then almost all the twins disappear. So there is high amount of twinning, high amount of detwinning when you change the strain into opposite. It's quite difficult to model, but of course we have the volume transfer scheme. We can also reduce the twins. Yeah, we can reduce the twinning volume of the twinning variants, which we call detwinning, each time when the strain is inverted. What were the modeling parameters here? I show them. Well, only those grains were considered in the simulation which we saw in this EBSD map. There were only 107 mother grains there, to which we added to each grain orientation, we added six twins, so total 749 grains were present initially in the and all the time in the simulation. Secondary twinning was not considered. It seemed to be irrelevant in magnesium AZ31. The microstructures did not show secondary twinning. Hardening was not needed to implement into the modeling. So we just had to use constant reference stresses for the slip systems and the twinning systems. This is quite surprising, perhaps, to you, because this is the experimental strain hardening curve, and we see that there is kind of hardening and then and softening and hardening and softening. Yeah, but that's the situation. Because twins appear and they are in harder or softer orientations, and then they intervene immediately in the stress strain behavior, and automatically, without forcing a strain hardening on the material, they produce the necessary twin stress level. So it also showed that cyclic deformation of AZ31 does not involve intrinsic strain hardening of the material. quite surprising. But we saw already, in even in other cases, for larger deformations, that in many cases, in for magnesium, without strain hardening, the experimental hardening curve is obtained. For large strains, because of the texture change. Texture is changing rapidly, especially for twinning, which involves different stress level automatically in the material. So, coming back to the modeling parameters, strain hardening was not needed in order to reproduce the cyclic stress strain curves, but they were reproduced. Slip systems. In hexagonal crystal structure, we have the basal and the pyramidal, and of course, then the prismatic slip systems. Here, it was only necessary to use the basal, the three basal slip systems with 5 megapascal strength. The 12 pyramidal C plus A type systems were used at 55 megapascal strength. And the 6 twinning tensile twins, 1, 0, -1, 2, were attributed to 40 megapascal critical reference stress for twinning, and for detwinning to 30 megapascal. They had 2 were used. Detwinning was favored. If you do not do detwinning, then the results is impossible to reproduce. The volume fractions do not come at all. The stress strain curve doesn't come at all. So detwinning was a very important mechanism in this modeling. Strain rate sensitivity of slip was 0.1. Well, then this is the large value, 0.1. That's the M value. Of course, magnesium is at room temperature, is at already at quite high temperature for magnesium. But we discussed that high value of strain rate sensitivity is also producing the rounding of the yield surface, which is a good effect in crystal plasticity. Elasticity, of course, was considered, and magnesium single crystal is known what are the elasticity coefficients. They are measured. They are represented here. The fourth order tensor elasticity matrix is reduced here for 2 dimensions in gigapascal. And these are the elasticity coefficients what we identified from literature and used in the simulations. Elasticity, because it's important in fatigue, is defined in the crystal reference system. So, but the simulation, the whole simulation is done in the sample reference system. So this matrix, which belongs to the crystal elasticity, has to be rotated into the sample reference system and used there. That requires quite a manipulation for different complicated rotation operation because of the fourth order tensor. You have to express a fourth order tensor in another reference system that requires to use the orientation transformation matrix 4 times. So now here I show some results for the hardening and the slip system activity. So here this is, we saw it already, the experimental strain hardening, which is a constant hysteresis curve, doesn't evolve during straining, it remains constant. This also shows there is no intrinsic strain hardening in the material. The simulation is not distinguishable from the experiment. As in general, with the crystal plasticity modeling, strain hardening or hardening of the material, there is no strain hardening actually, just apparent strain hardening. but it's always reproduced. Of course, you have to play a little bit with the parameters, what you have, but we do not really have many. What we really had to change is these values here. What is the resistance for basal slip? That's the easiest in magnesium, like 5 MPa. And then to find the appropriate value for the pyramidal slip, which we identified 55, 11 times harder. And the tensile twinning, which was 40 MPa for twinning and 30 MPa for detwinning. So these were the three parameters, actually, which had to be changed in order to get the results. Nothing else. There are no other parameters, because we do not have strain hardening introduced. And this is a Taylor-Lin model. There is no alpha parameter in it, you know, there is no interaction equation. Elasticity is perfectly defined. So there is no parameter in the simulation, only the strength of the slip and twinning systems. Very few. Only three. But the simulation reproduces perfectly the experiment for the stress-strain curve. And then we looked at the activity of twinning and slip. This diagram here shows the slip and twinning shear values in one cycle. This is cycle number 5. So it begins here and it is terminating there. This is time here in seconds. So we can see the basal slip system activity is this one. We see the pyramidal activity is pretty low, pyramidal. It's not zero, but this is very low. And then we see the twinning. Twinning activity is this one. So there is a lot of twinning in one half of the cycle, then it is decreasing. The detwinning activity is happening in the second part of the cycle. This curve is all the shears together, all the shears of basal and pyramidal together are here. So one this is just to show how this cyclic variation is happening during one cycle. Now, and some interpretation of the twinning behavior will be done now here. When we look at the so-called yield surface, which belongs to the twinning, not to the slip, but to the twinning, then we can identify schematically this kind of yield surface. This is schematic, it's not real one. Just to explain that during cyclic deformation, what happens? Although the yield surface was rounded, but here it is shown more or less not rounded, but schematically it is very similar. And because twinning and detwinning do not have the same stresses, but they belong to the same plane, you know, this is twinning plane and twinning plane. So at this part, when the detwinning happens, then the stress levels are lower. And this is which belongs to twinning. This is the twinning yield surface. And here, this is the detwinning. And here, only twinning happens. The cyclic deformation is such that for a grain, this is in one grain, the stress state is moving cyclically on the yield surface. So it begins initially in the zero, because the material has zero stress. And then increasing the strain amplitude, we arrive to the twinning plane. Twinning happens. And then stress state will move to a vertex to reach multiple slip, which is needed. Single slip usually not enough to make the deformation, even for small strains. So it is moving to a vertex, and then it stays there. Then unloading happens, elastic, so it is parallel to that one. And then opposite strain, it reaches the other side. Here detwinning happens, and then the stress state continues to move, looking for a vertex. Found the vertex, stays there for some time, and then loading again is happening. So this is the final movement during cyclic deformation on the yield surface of the stress state. This point is only initially when we start. After it is never crossed. This is how it goes cyclically all the time within the crystal. Everything is periodically repeated. But when we finally decide to unload, we stop the experiment. Cyclic deformation is stopped and we take the sample out. So a complete unloading. Then actually, as you see, because this is the trajectory, it never comes back to the zero. When the whole sample is unloaded, then a stress state will be found somewhere which is not in zero. So not the grains, all the grains do not are not unloaded. They remain in elastic deformation. This is inside is the elasticity, somewhere like here. For each grain, there will be internal or how it is called, residual stress after unloading. This is because of the elasticity. And that's also called this elastic stress or residual stress, the result of so-called kinematic hardening. The fact that a stress state is moving on the Earth's surface, it has to move. It can be shown analytically. The relation, it's right here. Sigma dot is C times D elastic. If there is elastic strain, and the strain is not perpendicular to the yield surface, then it has to move, there is sigma dot. So it's going to move on the yield surface. That's called kinematic hardening. This equation is describing the so-called kinematic hardening, which is automatic in the crystal plasticity. It's not invented, it is not inserted or injected into the modeling. This is intrinsic. You don't need to put it in. So that kinematic hardening is happening automatically. This is the kinematic when it is moving on the yield surface. And when we unload the whole specimen, then residual stress remains in each crystal. And the simulation knows that. We unload the whole specimen in the simulation, and then for each grain we can obtain these. And at any point, even in a loading point like here, that is the maximum loading point of the material, there we can examine in the simulation what are the stresses in the grains. But the most interesting is, of course, the twinning activity. So here I show you the result of our analysis for the twinning activity. You can see the twins here, the experimental ones. And you can see some white lines. I hope they are visible. The white lines here, they show the traces of the simulated twins. It's not topological, of course. You shouldn't believe that we did a topological calculation. This is a polycrystal averaging scheme. But of course, we know each orientation. And in each grain, we can trace how the twin variant should appear. And they do appear in the same variant. The same variants are seen as in the experiment, except in a few cases. But there are cases when there is no twinning. These are the circle, identified with a circle. These grains do not twin. they do not twin experimentally, as you can see, and they do not twin either in the simulation. This is why we put these circles. All the others, where there is a segment, it shows the intersection of the twin with the mother grain surface. And this is the real twin, which is observed. Always the same variants are produced. Out of this 105 grains, only there were two or three cases when the variant was not produced. And I can see perhaps here one. This was predicted, but these are the real experimental ones. You can also see that the direction is not always the same, the intersection. But twins, when they appear like that, they do not necessarily appear in the intersection expected position. Don't think that because a twin is elongated like this, it means that its twinning plane is cutting the surface of the crystal in that direction. Not because there is twinning growth. Twin appears usually at the grain boundary and it's growing. And its growth is not necessarily on the same direction as the twinning plane. The growth can have slightly different directions, so much that even 5 degrees differences can be seen. But the orientation inside the twin is exactly the twinning orientation. It's just the direction of growth is different, slightly. Not too much, up to about 5 degrees, usually. So almost each time, you can see some differences, small differences in the direction of the real twin and then the expected intersection line of the twin with the mother. Simulated pole figures here are shown. By the simulation, we got the twinning appearing at these positions, like in the experiment, with pretty good agreement. Otherwise, the texture, of course, didn't change too much, because the mother grains, the mother orientations, do not change their orientation. But what is new in this modeling, really? Well, it was a twinning. This was one of the first time when this volume transfer scheme was used. This is published in Acta Materialia about 4 years ago. And the other is that because we have elasticity, Taylor-Lin theory is elastic, we can calculate the residual stresses. We can also calculate the stress state in each grain at any point. So here we have results for the fully loaded state. And we can distinguish between twins and mother grains. So the different stress components, here is sigma 1-1. Of course, it was loaded in a 3-3 direction. So this is this was minus 65 megapascal. That was the loading in compression. And we can see what are the stress values in the mother grains. These are here. No, these are the twins. Twin states. And the red lines, they show the frequency numbers of mother grains having these stress values. There are much more. Here this is number distribution. So that 6 times more number of twins are there than mother grains, of course. So this is why the red is smaller and the other is 6 times larger. You can see that there is only compression stress, of course, in both the mother grains and in the twins. other components average are zero. Average, but individually they vary from minus 20 to plus 20 megapascal, as you can see. And here also the average value sigma 1 1, it's zero, average is zero, but one can see that the mother grains are here, and the, all the twins, they are having a large negative compression stress in them. This is in the fully loaded state, so it is at the top of this hysteresis curve, no, at the bottom, minus 65 megapascal. We can also look at the distribution of the stresses, the residual stresses, after unloading. So unloading in the experiment and also in the simulation is just progressively we decrease the stress level, the strain, going back to a general stress so that all the stress components are zero. Sigma 3-3 also, sigma 1-1 and 2-2, all the stress components are zero, unloaded. And then we can look at the residual stresses remaining in the crystals. Here is the red ones are the mother grains, and the gray ones, they are the twins. You can see there are large differences, especially for sigma 2-2 and sigma 1-1. Sigma 1-1 is negative residual stress for the twins, but it's positive for the sigma 2-2. The mother grains, they are always having some kind of average zero. And for the sigma 3-3, well, there is positive and there is negative also. So the most interesting is that these stress distributions are one is positive, the other is negative. So all these information are quite useful for the practical purposes, because they belong, I believe them, and they are quite near to the experimental work. At the end, as conclusion, I can tell you that one of the most interesting result was that without intrinsic hardening, it was is possible to reproduce the stress-strain curve in cyclic deformation with high precision with experiments. And we applied the volume transfer scheme for twinning simulations. And that simulation permitted with a high precision to identify the same variants as in the experiment, although we also applied selection criteria to preferring those slip systems which had the minimum elastic energy in them. And of course, because it's elastic plastic, it's possible to obtain the elastic strains and stresses in any state, loaded or unloaded state. And in this way, the residual stresses in the material which remain can be simulated and can be used after for further purposes. So this is an example which is a completely different modeling from the viscoplastic self-consistent model. I will show you also some other examples in the afternoon. And then tomorrow, I invite you that you bring your laptop with you, and we will enjoy together to make simulation and to get some practice in obtaining nice textures, comparing with experiments and so on, and plot them with the JTEX software. So two softwares will be needed to install on your computers. They are both free, the viscoplastic code of Los Alamos and the JTEX texture code from France, from Metz. Okay, and then see you then in the afternoon from about 3 o'clock.
Sir?
Yeah.
Sir, your model you started like mother grain, which can take up six orientations.
Seven. Mother grain is one and six others, so it's seven.
So when deformation started, like it's the tensile first case, then it could take any one of the orientation according to the deformation state over it?
Yeah. Automatically.
The question here is, what is the location where it will take? Was it so much specified? Like, it's a grain, it's a big grain. The twin could be throughout it, it could be in a small patch. And when the stress strain is changing to compression, when detwinning is happening, detwinning may not happen and there may be another twin form in another direction. And then that may interact in the next cycle of the deformation.
Like, yes, well, all this is. Produced naturally by the code, you know, it's happening by the mechanics, which is implemented in the code. So it's not, we are not controlling it, we are not intervening in the code to make the twinning happen. And which twinning systems feel active? They are activated because we consider them as a pseudo slip. So we have stresses on the twinning planes. We assume a critical stress for twinning to happen, and then we calculate using the same viscoelastic law how much shear strain should happen, and then automatically the corresponding volume to this shear strain, it represents volume, is made, added to the twin orientation. All is automatic. And of course, all this is twinning, detwinning, is happening naturally. There is no further control in it. And only three parameters, which I said we could change, is only the strength of the slip systems and the twinning systems. So there was only four parameters in the simulation. Four. To obtain all these agreements with almost in all the grains, the same variants were produced, and of course the overall final volume fraction of twins were produced. Indeed, the detwinning was so heavy that twinning, there's no detwinning, would be 100% already after a small strain. And here, after 6,000 cycles, it was only 15%. So it's almost all the twins disappeared, just a small fraction remained in one cycle.